In a series of letters exchanged between James Clerk Maxwell and Pierre Trait, Maxwell suggested the possibility of a revolutionary machine. Maxwell's machine was an isolated chamber divided into two equal parts that contained an arbitrary gas. However, there stood in between the chamber, on the line dividing it, what he described as a finite being, what Lord Kelvin later described as a demon. Maxwell's being is called a demon because he is very cunning, and you'll understand why in a moment. The molecules of a gas are known to travel at the same speed, but this is only the average speed. Individually, a few molecules travel fast and thereby generate more heat, while the others travel slow and generate less heat, leaving the average speed and temperature somewhere in the middle. What Maxwell's demon does is filter the gas. It separates the faster molecules from the slower molecules by cleverly opening and shutting the gate between them. Eventually, there exist only high-energy molecules in one chamber and low-energy molecules in the other. The demon has raised the temperature and therefore the pressure of one chamber in comparison to the other. This pressure difference can be used to push a piston or a turbine to power an engine or create electricity. Notice that the demon has not broken the law of conservation of energy. The energy in the isolated chamber is constant. The demon has merely redistributed it. Maxwell's machine produces energy out of nothing. However, demons don't exist, or at least we haven't found one yet. But what about this machine? Look at it carefully. There's no demon up to something sneaky, yet the machine produces energy from the very energy it produces? Because such a machine works perpetually, it is called a perpetual motion machine. Coil a magnet around the wheel's circumference and fix two magnets adjacent to it, and you can produce AC current forever. If this revolutionary machine is so easy to build, why isn't it ubiquitous? Isn't unlimited, unconditional energy the dream, the technology of our utopian future? Well, there's a catch. In fact, the technology was realized by Nicholas Carnot, the father of thermodynamics, 200 years ago, and was repudiated at that very instant. Carnot realized that such a machine is a physical impossibility, as no system can do work with 100% efficiency. Some usable energy, say, the fuel, is inevitably spent on raising its internal temperature. This is unusable energy, and the measure of this unusable energy is called entropy. Entropy in a machine, or technically an isolated system, will only increase. This is the second law of thermodynamics, and it is one of the most fundamental and indisputable laws of the universe. Entropy is ordinarily called a measure of disorder because unusable energy, such as the heat given off by a tirelessly working engine, is considered disorder. On the other hand, usable energy is extracted from order, and this order, in an isolated system, due to the increase in the system's internal temperature, is destined to be disturbed and diminish. The perpetual motion machine cannot be actualized because the bearings are not frictionless. They eventually lose their mobility and come to a halt as the kinetic energy is converted to frictional heat, however gradual the rate. Basically, disorder is bound to be introduced. In fact, if you're still wondering why such a machine shouldn't work, ask yourself, what's wrong with this? On the other hand, Maxwell's demon cannot be actualized because it must consume energy to detect the particles and open and close the gate. Once all of its usable energy is converted into unusable energy through internal heating, it is rendered unworkable. Only entropy will then reign over the chamber. The only way the demon and the ball-bearing machine can be made to work again is if we replenish them with more usable energy, if we restore order. This can only be achieved externally, thereby making the system no longer isolated. For instance, say that you are a machine whose sole objective is to clean and organize dishes. However, because no machine can do work with full efficiency, you purge the dishes of only 90% of the germs. Eventually, as you extinguish your finite energy, entropy in the sink increases as the remaining 10% reproduce. To bring the quantity of germs back down to 10%, you must be replenished, which is achieved through food, which plants would have stopped producing if the sun hadn't been bathing them with its light. Bear in mind that all three of those systems, you, the plant, and the sun, are not fully efficient. Of all the usable energy they produce, some is destined to be dissipated as unusable heat. However, what happens when the sun itself runs out of usable energy, after it has exhausted all of its hydrogen and helium? Stars are the universe's primary source of energy, and once every one of them has eventually exhausted its fuel, no more energy can be produced. Order cannot be restored externally either, because the universe is the ultimate isolated system. It cannot extract energy from its surroundings, because nothing lies outside of it. We might reduce entropy in the kitchen, but order in the universe is finite. We can extract order from it only at the expense of dispensing disorder into it. Therefore, entropy in the universe, like in any isolated system, inexorably increases. It is increasing as you're watching this video. Why does disorder, entropy, and chaos dominate the universe? No mysterious force drives the second law of thermodynamics. It is not an inherent feature built into the cosmos. Entropy dominates simply because disorder is statistically more probable than order. Think about it. There are obviously many ways to arrange the parts to not form a sofa, but there's only one way to arrange them to make the sofa correctly. Or consider a sandcastle. Any volume of sand is utter, complete chaos, and there are only a handful of unique ways to arrange the trillions of grains to form a highly structured castle. But even that will eventually be annihilated by a wave. Entropy reigns simply because it is more probable. The instant the universe's last star radiates its final photons, entropy will be so indescribably high in the universe that its every inhabitant would have already decayed and perished. An organism wouldn't be able to extract order from its surroundings because its surroundings would be more disordered than the organism itself. At that point, the universe will become cold and lifeless. This is called the heat death, and it is one of the ways that physicists predict the cosmos will reach the end of its illustrious journey. In other words, enjoy the summer while it lasts.